For 8 straight years, we heard conservative politicians and pundits tell us almost every day that we needed to be at war in places like Iraq, we needed to be at war in Afghanistan, and then anyone who didn't support those wars, well, they were unpatriotic. Bush and Cheney and Don Rumsfeld, well, they were all beating the drums of war within days of 9/11, attacks that they failed to prevent. That attack they failed to prevent, that fell on their shoulders, even though they had the intelligence, had all the information, they failed on their watch. And then they proceeded to get us bogged down into 2 unwinnable wars with no clear goals. Didn't even know why we were there. It started off as weapons of mass destruction. That was a lie. And then it was some other reason and some other reason. And after the failures of the war hawk policies of Bush, why are conservatives, think about this, why are they still telling us that they're the people who are best suited to handle national security? Well, joining me now to help answer questions like that is Corey Robin, author of the new book, The Reactionary Mind. Corey, give me your best description of the war hawk. What is it that goes on in their odd little head?
Well, I think the first thing to stress is that they don't actually care about security at all. In fact, they don't really want security because security to their mind means that your society is safe, it's calm, it's peaceful, and it's protected. It's orderly. And that, and even though they sometimes say those things and people tend to buy their argument, they're actually not interested in that at all because they think that makes a society soft. It makes it complacent. It makes it decadent. And this is a very, the war hawks today are not new. This is something that goes back to the 19th century. What they've always wanted is a much more vital, much more engaging, exciting, intoxicating experience in life, which they think you can find through war. Now, of course, many of them themselves don't fight wars at all, personally, but it's an idea. I call it a romance.
With somebody else's life, somebody else's child, somebody else's son, daughter, husband, right?
Exactly. It's like a movie, and in the same way that you go to a movie to experience something from afar that you yourself are not undergoing, that's what war is for them. And it really is a romance. Because they think that the world that we live in is just too calm, and you kind of need to sort of throw a bomb every once in a while in order to kind of generate the experience that they want to see.
Well, you know, by the way, Corey, this is a great book. I mean, it is just, it's like Chris Mooney's book, The Republican Brain. It just gives you so much insight into that oddball at the water cooler who's never fought a war, never picked up a gun, want somebody else to do it. But war is always glamorous. You mentioned something here I want to talk about. It's this counter-enlightenment idea.
Mm-hmm.
This idea, as you pointed out, it found a place in the years of fascist triumph.
Mm-hmm.
Men equal war, women equal maternity. I think as Mussolini had something.
Right.
Talk about that, because that really talks, it really talks about this romanticism that these oddballs have about war.
Right. Well, you know, the Enlightenment arises in the 18th century, and we all know what that is. It's about bringing reason, rule, law, calm, light to the world. And the conservative counter-Enlightenment is horrified by that idea, not because they don't think it's possible. In fact, they're horrified because they think it is possible. And once you have light, that means there's no darkness. Once you have rule, that means there's no disruption. And so what conservatives did throughout the 19th century, and it really culminated with fascism, was to try to reverse the tendency of the Enlightenment and to try to find a kind of politics that would reverse the Enlightenment. And that was what fascism was all about. It really put war, and in the case of not the Nazis, race war at the center. That was the vision. Mm-hmm. Was warfare, mm-hmm. because in warfare you get heroic exploits, you get triumphant excitement, and the whole idea of the chicken hawk, that there's a distance between the romance and the reality, is actually true also of Mussolini. So, for instance, he makes a big deal in all of his speeches and his memoirs of the March on Rome, where he supposedly took control of Italy. Well, there was no March on Rome. He went overnight on the train from Milan in the sleeper car, having gone to the opera the night before.
Right.
And the reason he's able to get into Rome is because the king gives him the key to the city. So there's always this mismatch between this romantic, glorious vision and the reality, which is usually you know, quite the opposite.
Yeah, I remember Thin Red Line. You know, when Thin Red Line hit the bookstores, you know, it was so criticized, because what it really did is it painted the picture not of that romanticism, but of the reality.
Yes.
That it was somebody else's kid.
Yes.
You know, it was somebody else's mother, father, son, daughter that was being killed out there.
Right.
And one thing you've done, I can't tell you, this book nails it. It's just so good.
Right.
But this grand idea of, you know, we're going to democratize the Middle East. We're going to go there and we're going to make them a better culture, a better society. That's nonsense. It had appeal on television, but that wasn't the reason. It was this romantic notion of the war, wasn't
right.
it?
Right, exactly. And that's why when it came to the actual reconstruction, right, why was that such a disaster? Well, because that's about bureaucracy. That's about building institutions. That's about kind of, you know, getting people in offices, you know, to do the kind of, like, you know, is the water running? Are the pipes fixed?
Right.
All this kind of boring, humdrum details of everyday life, which these guys wanted to be free from. That was the whole point of the war.
Yeah.
So you don't want to go in and then have to kind of deal with the housekeeping afterwards.
Corey, this you describe is this restless need to prove themselves. It's almost like these guys play paintball. You know, they go shoot paintballs at each other on weekends, and they think, well, you know,
they have motorcycles.
Right. They smoke cigars, and you know, they shave their heads and grow goatees. I don't know what the hell goes through their head, but it's something like they have this. It's not really a self-awareness that's accurate.
Right.
It's this restless need to prove themselves. Is that the common theme here, if I were to come away from this discussion?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really important that, you know, when these guys think about the world and they think about the United States, the place in the world, they're really actually not thinking about the external reality at all. They're really thinking about their role in history. I mean, I close at the end and I say, you know, they're like actors on a stage mm-hmm, who wonder what mm-hmm. the next day's reviews
well
are going to bring.
Yeah, well
you know?
Put, right.
And it's, you know, it's like imagine Liza Minnelli playing the part of Henry Kissinger or, you know, George W. Bush, because that is real.
That's real.
It sounds cute, but that is, I mean, they are divas of war.
Right.
And wondering, right. you know, how their audience is perceiving them. And
yeah.
that's, you know, there's no other, you know, that's what is going on when these guys are thinking about this.
And that reactionary mind, unfortunately, Corey, it defines the Republican mind. Corey Robin, very, very good work. The Reactionary Mind. Everybody go to read this. Maybe you can understand what in the hell that fool at the coffee counter or the water cooler is talking about. Thanks for joining me, okay?
Thank you.
Never miss another show. Podcast Big Eddie for only $25 a year at WeGotEd.com.